In this lesson, we're going to look at the four levels of protein structure. We're also going to look specifically at two types of structure that happen in the secondary structure, and we're going to look at the interactive forces in each level of protein structure. So we've already talked about polypeptides, which are just a sequence of amino acids. The only difference between a polypeptide and a protein is size and function. Proteins tend to have a very specific job in the body, and they tend to be fairly large. But the definition of where a polypeptide stops and a protein ends is very vague, and we will use the terms interchangeably. For the most part, we'll be looking at these proteins because we're looking at very large molecules that are biologically relevant. So when we look at proteins, what we see is that it's not just about the sequence of amino acids. And when we looked at the dipeptides or tripeptides, we looked at the sequence of how those amino acids were bonded to one another. And we still see that in proteins, and that's what we know up here as primary structure. And so when we look at our primary structure, what we see is that we have peptide bonds, and that's basically the sequence of amino acids that we have in this molecule. So we see a proline, tyrosine, serine, methionine, lysine, okay? We have this sequence of amino acids. That's our peptide bonds forming that are holding those together. But that alone is not enough to make a protein functional. And so what we have are different levels of structure. And we're going to go into more detail on each of these three different levels of structure. For the secondary structure, what we see is we see two major features present there. We see a beta pleated sheet and an alpha helix. For tertiary structure, we start to see lots of more bends and twists as different parts of the protein interact with other parts of the protein. You can kind of think of like a wadded ball of yarn. And then for some proteins, we get to what's called a quaternary structure, and that's where we have multiple things that look like the tertiary structure that come together and act as one unit. Now this example is of hemoglobin. It actually has four different pieces that come together, but the quaternary structure is about the level of structure, and we could actually have quaternary structures with 2, 3, 4, 5, even more of these peptides coming together to function together as a protein. So the first thing we want to look at is our secondary structure, and what's holding that secondary structure together are hydrogen bonds. And so when we look at this, what we see happening is that there's interactions between different parts of the molecule that are holding it together in these shapes. And so we see two different options for the structure in the secondary structure. We see the alpha helix, and so it kind of looks similar to what you're used to seeing as the double helix that's present in DNA. So we see this kind of cycling step here. And so we see that we have amino acids. And where we see hydrogen bonding occurring is not between amino acids that are next to each other in the sequence, but amino acids that are separated from one another in the sequence. So they're fairly close. They're only a few amino acids away, but the interactions are happening. In this case, we see this hydrogen's interacting with this oxygen, and so it's about 4 or 5 amino acids away from one another. So we have some fairly close range, but not neighboring amino acids that are interacting from one another. We see something similar when we look at a beta pleated sheet. We start to see interactions occurring that are resulting in this kind of fan fold here of our amino acids. And this is just an effect of the way the amino acids are structured in that particular sequence of amino acids. Because we talk about the primary structure being kind of the minimal connection between the amino acids, but it's also very important because if we had the wrong amino acid in that protein structure, in that primary structure, we may not form the correct secondary, tertiary, or quaternary structure. And that's what actually leads to some genetic defects because our body cannot produce a protein that we need. Some of these defects are inconvenient, like say being lactose intolerant because your body doesn't produce lactase. Some of them are fatal, such as cystic fibrosis, which can have some serious long-term and even fatal consequences. When we go on to tertiary structure, we don't see the patterns like we saw in the secondary structure, but what we start to see is we start to see interactions happening between different pieces of this molecule. Now, we call these interactive forces, but you'll notice they look much like the intermolecular forces that we looked at earlier on when we were talking about interactions between molecules. And so we can talk about hydrophobic, so those are nonpolar interactions, so more like dipole-dipole interactions. We have hydrogen bonding, and remember our rule for hydrogen bonding. It's a hydrogen attached to a fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, attracted to the fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen on a neighboring molecule. We can also see some ionic bond where we have the positive and negative from our basic amino acid side chain and our acidic amino acid side chain. And we can also see some what we call disulfide bridges, because remember we have some amino acids with sulfur in them. Notice that all of the interactions we're looking at occur between the side chains of the amino acids. These are not occurring with this polypeptide backbone. It's occurring between the side chains. Now, the interesting thing about disulfide linkages, as you've probably all experienced or been around this, is when you're getting your hair chemically straightened or getting a perm, and what you're actually doing is breaking the disulfide linkages in your hair, which are proteins, and then forcing them to form in a different pattern, either curly or straight, whichever one you're trying to get to. Now, those don't last forever, but they will last for a while, those kind of forced disulfide linkages. Now we're looking at quaternary structure, our fourth degree of structure. And in this case, we're looking at the example of hemoglobin. And what we see is that there are four peptides which come together and form overall hemoglobin. These peptides alone cannot function and carry oxygen in the body that we need our entire protein molecule of hemoglobin with all four of these peptides in order to serve its function. Not all proteins will form a quaternary structure, and some will have different numbers of peptides that form that quaternary structure. When we look at the interactions that hold the quaternary structure together, we see the same things that we saw in the tertiary structure. Disulfide bridges, hydrophobic interactions, ionic bonds, all of those are present in the quaternary structure as well as the tertiary structure. The key difference is that in the tertiary structure, the interactions occur between the side chains of amino acids that are in the same polypeptide sequence. When we look at a quaternary structure, what we see is now that the interactions are occurring between different polypeptide chains. Same types of interactions, but occurring in a different way.